So the next talk of this session will be given by Luisa Papachristou-Doulou on the practical evaluation of protected RNS scalar multiplication.
Yeah, better? Okay. Okay, yeah, thank you for the introduction. So this work is the practical evaluation of protected RNS scalar multiplication. This is a joint work with my co-authors Apostolos Fournaris, Kostas Papagiannopoulos and Leila Batina. I'm currently working at Navinfo Europe, but this work was done while I was a PhD student at Radboud University, and I was also visiting the University of Patras in Greece. So this is the outline of my talk. First, I'm going to talk briefly about the residue number system and how we can use it in elliptic curve cryptography. Then I'm going to show some proposed TVLA threshold calculation that we found during this work. And then I'm going to show you the results of TVLA analysis of the traces of RNS. And then some location and data-dependent template attacks, and finally some conclusions. RNS has potential to be used broadly in public key cryptography because it offers a fast, efficient, and parallel way of operations. And it is used already in RSA and some ECC implementations. The potential of RNS as a side channel attack countermeasure is already shown in some publications, and they mostly there are some theoretical works showing this, but now this is the first work that presents many practical experiments and shows the resistance of RNS in against some side channel attacks. So RNS is an extension of the Chinese remainder theorem and is a non-positional arithmetic system where a number X is represented by a set of individual numbers, X1, X2, Xn, of a given base B. This base has co-prime numbers Mi, and the number can be reconstructed from RNS to binary if we apply the Chinese remainder theorem. RNS was initially used for digital signal processing and for parallel processing of arithmetic operations in order to increase the computational speed. As an example, you can see here that the number 50, if we have the RNS base 3711, would be 216. So yeah, as you can see, we can have, especially when we have large prime fields, and we can make the operations we can make them into smaller dynamic ranges, and in this way we can reduce complexity and we can increase the computational speed in, during the calculations. In this work, we used elliptic curves over prime fields, and we implemented RNS on elliptic curves. All the modular operations that we know can be easily turned to RNS modular operations. So addition, subtraction, and multiplication happen in a regular way. The only problem is with division and inversion because RNS is a non-positional representation. So for this, there are some algorithms, base extension algorithms that they are used in order to change from one base to the other. The RNS modular multiplication is usually realized through RNS Montgomery multiplication in order to avoid division, inversion, but we have to use some base extension algorithms which add some overhead in our implementations. And still here in the RNS case, the critical operation is the scalar multiplication, so we want to protect the secret scalar K. This is an example of the Montgomery power ladder, how it is implemented usually with choosing some input points and converting them to Montgomery format, then having a for loop over the bits of the scalar. And then we have always addition and doubling, but according to the manipulated key bit, these values are stored in different registers. But it's a very regular algorithm, as you know, and it can easily be extended to RNS by just, in the beginning, we need to choose some initial bases that we work with, and we represent our numbers with these bases. Then we transform our points on the curve, we transform them to RNS format, and we choose a permutation PT. This is a permutation of the coprime elements of the bases. In order to add some extra randomness, we can have these elements permuted in a random way, and then we just choose for every computation we need to do, we choose a different permutation of the elements. And then every time we represent, we have the point on curve, we have to represent it in RNS format in the chosen permutation. And at the end of the algorithm, we need to transform our result back to binary format. These are just the extra steps that we need to do if we want to do Montgomery ladder in RNS. And actually, this algorithm is the one that we use in different variations in the experiments that we did. And that's the basic algorithm that we work with. So first of all, we performed TVLA, the test vector leakage assessment, which is a methodology broadly used for evaluating the security of a device. So this methodology consists of several statistical tests between two trace sets of acquisition, one that is obtained with a random input and one with a fixed input. And this test provides results simultaneously for all intermediate values and indicates points of potential leakage. This leakage is not exploitable with TVLA, but we need to perform further attacks in order to exploit them. It is commonly used, this 4.5 threshold of this value SI, and values that are above this threshold indicate leakage. But as we saw while we were implementing this TVLA to our experiments, we saw that there were some peaks in places where we didn't expect it. And going to literature, we found that there are similar ghost peaks in public key implementations. TVLA was mostly used for symmetric key. And so in public key, when we use more samples per trace, it's common to have some peaks that are above the 4.5. So what we did is we proposed this threshold calibration for TVLA. That's an algorithm that depends on the number of traces in the groups that we choose, the number of samples per trace, and the distribution, the sample standard deviation of our measurements. And the output would be the threshold value for calculating the TVLA. So in this algorithm, we use, we noticed that with a more number of samples, the family-wise error rate would also go higher. So we need to apply the SITA correction that's also proposed in 2017 or 18 says to use the SITA correction. We just put together all the formulas, and then you can calculate your threshold according to the current acquisition using the last formula. For example, for our case where we had the number of traces in the order of thousands, 4 to 10,000 traces, and the number of samples we had 400,000 to 800,000, and we had these standard deviations, the threshold in our case was 6.3. And there were some other papers, like one from Smilevsky from 2017, that they had 32 million samples per trace. And when we put this in our algorithm, the threshold for their case should be 7.3. You see that we shouldn't take for granted this 4.5 when we do analysis in public key. So further, what we did is we had this C software implementation of RNS. We put it on a BeagleBone, and We tried with the RNS Montgomery multiplication and different curves and dedicated and unified group law. And also we had different variations of our algorithm. First we had unprotected with no countermeasures applied. Then we had typical side channel countermeasures as randomization of scalar and randomization of point. And then we had RNS specific countermeasures. One that's the leak resistant arithmetic, which basically does random base of permutations. And also we tried with random order of operations where things could happen in parallel, and yeah, we just changed the order of operations. For our analysis, we needed to do some processing of the traces, so we applied a low-pass filter, we did ABS, and we also needed to align. So usually we were collecting about 50k traces, and at the end, we, after alignment, we are left with about 20k traces. And we used half of the trace. We used some traces for the t-test. For the t-test, so this one shows the t-test for a random versus fixed scalar on the twisted Edwards curve with these parameters. In the first picture, you see the leakage. So when we have the unprotected scalar multiplication, then when we do randomization of the scalar, we can see that the leakage is a bit less, but still we can identify the rounds. So we were collecting traces for seven rounds, and we could see it. Then the LRA countermeasure, that's actually working better than randomization of scalar. So we have only some leakage in the beginning, and then it's under our threshold. And then what we didn't expect was when we have LRA and randomization of point, so we had the combination of these two countermeasures, we had actually much more leakage in the beginning. We tried different things. These were not ghost peaks, so the peaks were there. Probably it's because of the device, because it's there is a lot of leakage in the beginning, and maybe some values are sent in clear, and that's why in the first round we have this big leakage, but then later with the rounds it disappears. Then we tried also some other curves, a secure Edwards curve with these parameters, and the results there were a bit better. Again, in the unprotected case, we have a lot of leakage. When we do randomization of scalar, the leakage is much less than before. With the LRA countermeasure, in this case, we have a lot of leakage that propagates through all the rounds. But when we do the combination of the countermeasures, then the leakage is not there. This is the case when we do t-test for random versus fixed point. That's why when we randomize the point and we test for this, then indeed this countermeasure works, and the leakage is, as expected, is low. Then we did some template attacks. First, we exploited data-dependent leakage, which is observed when the value of a secret variable is monitored by an adversary. This can happen when the variable is unprotected or when, at some point in the algorithm, is sent in clear. So in our case, we triggered around the key-dependent assignment, which is the if statement, and we could, again, like we did alignment, and we ended up with 20k traces, and we used the half for templates and the other half for classification. And the success rates of correct classification was 90-91% for the unprotected case. With the LRA countermeasure activated, depending on the curve, and it was 82-97%. So again, it was successful. We could classify. And the cases where we had scalar randomization and LRA with randomized RNS operations, the classification rates were lower, 55-58%, 65-72%. And so we assume that in those cases, we couldn't we couldn't recover the scalar bits. And then we performed location-dependent template attacks. The templates were created based on the storage structure that handles the key-dependent instruction. In our case, was the Dublin. And so we triggered around the dubbing operation. So as I said before, the algorithm is very regular, but what changes is where the values are stored. And this indeed leaks some information. So we had a very successful template classification of 95 to 99.9%. And when the LRA countermeasure is activated with randomized operators, then this classification rate falls to 70 to 83%. Location dependent leakage was not something that we were expecting to see because we have large values and we were splitting them in four chunks of 50 bits. Each value is stored in different registers. What we expect is that this happened because the normal distributions of the collected traces indeed were different. This made it obvious from the experiments. And also the platform is leaky, so the capacitors are next to each other, and probably that's also a reason why the location-dependent leakage happens. We saw that scalar randomization is not an efficient countermeasure in all cases. It reduces sometimes the accuracy of the classification, but it's not so efficient as LRA with randomized operations. This is an evaluation table of all the different variations of the algorithm that we used, and with some performance overhead at the end, how much more time you need for your implementation. And from this, the last rows, the LRA with randomized operations seems to resist against more attacks, with 76% overhead. To conclude, I would like to say that TVLA bounds should not be taken for rigid. We should compute every time according to our acquisition and the distribution of traces, the number of samples, and the number of traces. We should compute our threshold bounds. And randomization of scalar, of input point, and the regularity of the Montgomery power ladder are good countermeasures, but not enough in all the cases to avoid leakage. Different RNS representations do not lower the template success rates, and also different shapes of the curve. Randomization of the RNS operation protects against template attacks and is less expensive compared to randomizing the input point. And what we are now considering for future work, and already started looking into this, is the classification using machine learning algorithms. And we could also avoid some alignment and try to use all the traces of the acquisition if the machine learning algorithms are successful. And it would be also interesting to have an evaluation on an FPGA and indeed have operations happening in parallel. Because that was a software implementation and we didn't do any performance optimizations. But if we would have a hardware implementation with this implementation, then we could we could examine further and we can have further insights on the security of RNS as a countermeasure. Thank you for your attention, and if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer.
Thank you. So I think we have time for a quick question.
Yeah. Thank you for the presentation. A very short question. You show experimentally that there is a leakage, even when we are using the scalar randomization or the RNS representation. But did you succeed to identify where is coming from, where the leakage is coming from? Because we could expect that there is no leakage because we use scalar randomization, so there is no longer information available normally.
Yeah.
So why do you see leakage? What in your implementation is causing the leakage?
Yeah, one thing could be the platform that is leaking, but in the implementation, we used functions as from the MPZ like the U-random and this function. So we used software randomization. I guess that was not a good source of randomness.
So the conclusion, because your conclusion is quite strong, you say scalar randomization is not sufficient to defeat such an attack, for instance, template attacks. But in your answer now, it seems that maybe this is not an issue of the scalar randomization, but with the way how you have implemented the randomness in the randomization, so the random generator or things like that.
Yeah, we tried like different things, different functions for randomization. We didn't have hardware randomization, so maybe if you have like five sources of randomness combined together in a true random generator, then maybe you don't have a scalar randomization issues. But in a simple, like straightforward way to implement it using a random function from the software, then.
Okay. Maybe just a second, a very short question. How did you generate the random base for the RNS representation? Did you each time regenerate the full basis, or did you took the primes in a fixed basis at random?
In a fixed
base of primes, of small primes at random. So my question is, do you really regenerate at for each execution the full base?
Not for each execution, in the beginning of the algorithm. Not for every execution taking a new random.
Ah, so not for every execution?
Yes.
Okay, so there is not so much randomness in the representation.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so as we are running out of time, let's thank the speaker again.